The forgiveness of all your sins through your faith in Jesus Christ as that comes to you once again in word and sacrament this morning. But for now, let us turn to our next song.
Thank you.
Testament lesson for this, the day of Pentecost, is taken from the book of Genesis, chapter 11. Now the whole earth had one language and the same words, and as people migrated from the east, they found a plain in the land of Shinar and Sela. And they said to one another, "Come, let us make bricks and burn them thoroughly." And they had brick for stone, and bitumen for mortar. And they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city, a tower with its top in the heavens. And let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be dispersed over the face of the whole earth." And the Lord came to see the city and the tower which the children of man had built. And the Lord said, "Behold, they are one people, and they all have one language. And this is only the beginning of what they will do. And nothing that they propose to do will now be impossible for them. Come, let us go down and there confuse their language, so that they may not understand one another's speech." So the Lord dispersed them from there over the face of all the earth, and they left off building the city. Therefore, its name was called Babel, because there the Lord confused the language of all the earth. And from there the Lord dispersed them over the face of all the earth. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading this morning is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 2. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place, and suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting, and divided tongues as a fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at the sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in his own native language? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians. We hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God." And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others, mocking, said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and give ear to my words. For these men are not drunk as you suppose, since it is only the third hour of the day. But this is what was uttered through the prophet Joel, 'And in the last days it shall be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. Even on my male servants and female servants in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapors of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the day of the Lord comes, the great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
These things I have spoken to you while I am still with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. You heard me say to you, I am going away, and I will come to you. If you loved me, you would have rejoiced, because I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it takes place, so that when it does take place, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming. He has no claim on me, but I do as the Father has commanded me, so that the world may know that I love the Father. Rise, let us go from here. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Christ.
Thank you.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
In our second lesson this morning from the book of Acts, we hear Luke reporting on the events of Pentecost, beginning with the arrival of the Holy Spirit and the miracle of speaking in tongues. The people responded to this miracle that they witnessed, as Luke tells us in verses 6 and 7. And at the sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished. This is our text this morning. Amen. Have you ever found yourself in a situation where you were completely unable to communicate with other people? And sometimes we do this kind of thing for fun, like with Pictionary or charades, where we intentionally limit what we're allowed to say or do in communicating to try and get people to guess what we're saying. And again, we do this because it's fun and it's a game and everybody has a good time, but when this happens in real life, it's not always so fun. So maybe you've been in a situation where you were trying to talk with someone who didn't speak English at all, or maybe a whole group of people, and you're trying to tell them something, or they're trying to tell you something, and you don't get it, you don't understand. It could be frustrating. Or maybe you've traveled abroad, and you've been in a country where none of the people spoke English. I mean, sometimes if you do this for a vacation or short trip, it can be kind of fun. I know for myself as an introvert, if you're like me, when I went abroad, and was surrounded by people who couldn't speak my language, it was paradise. You didn't have to talk to anybody. But that's good until it's not good. Because eventually, you do need to talk to people. You need human connection and communication on some level, no matter how much of an introvert you are. And there always comes a time when you need something. And it can be incredibly frustrating when you are trying to communicate and you can't. And so maybe you find yourself sleeping on a bench at a closed train station rather than on a sleeper car on the train because you couldn't talk to the ticket agent. You were speaking different languages. Well, this, again, can be very frustrating. But even if you spend your whole life in a country where they don't speak your language, eventually you'll learn their language and you'll learn their culture. And so it's not insurmountable. But can you imagine being in a situation where it was? Where you were surrounded your whole life by people you couldn't talk to? I remember growing up, there was a young man who lived in my neighborhood. He was older than me. I was a kid at the time. His name was Chris Tevitz. And this young man was one who suffered from cerebral palsy. So his mind was sound. He was really quite intelligent. But his body failed him. He couldn't walk. He could barely control his arms, and he couldn't speak. And yet he could drive around town in this little mechanical, battery-powered wheelchair. He loved to drive around, and no matter who he saw, he loved to stop and talk with them. And it was kind of amazing, because as I said, he couldn't speak. He could understand what you said, and he had this little book that he carried in the back of his wheelchair, and you could pull it out for him and unfold it. And had all these words typed out and spaced across the page, and he could kind of point at different words to form ideas and sentences, and he could talk. And I remember as a kid, talking with this young man, for us kids it was a fun game, trying to figure out what he was saying. But I bet it wasn't very fun for him. And now, as an adult, as I think back about Chris Tevitz, I think about him and it kind of makes me sad for him. But I'm also amazed and astounded at how he persevered and continued to thrive in a place of isolation that, again, would have been challenging, to say the least. Well, that isolation and that inability to communicate, that's really all the result of sin. I mean, for someone like Chris Tevitz, we can, of course, see this, because we know that all of our physical limitations are the result of sin. Whatever illness or injury or suffering that we face, it's all because Adam and Eve sinned and corrupted God's creation, and we all face these different challenges because of that sin that was brought in the world. But when it comes to language, we also know that God made a more direct intervention causing a disruption to our communication. That's what we hear about in the Old Testament lesson from Genesis. Because as the people there all spoke one language, they were working together to build this tower that reached up into the heavens. And the point of this was not the physical majesty of this building, but the sort of spiritual audacity. Like Adam and Eve, the first humans, had sought to put themselves in God's place, here again, generations later, the people were still trying to put themselves in God's place. So God came down and he separated their language. He made them unable to communicate with one another. And that limited their ability to work together, which in turn limited their ability to compound and magnify their sin. So ever since then, we've had different languages and different cultures, and our world has remained divided into different peoples. And all of this is to keep our sin from becoming too great. So yes, we have suffered greatly because we don't understand other nations and other cultures, and that's caused us a lot of trouble. But if God hadn't intervened to curb our sin and we hadn't had those divisions, imagine the amount of bad things that we maybe could have accomplished. But God kept us divided as he intended, and so we continue to deal with that division still today. And yet, even as we recognize God's hand in making us divided, we also know that he didn't leave us like this. So God always has a plan to fix things, always has a plan to undo the curses that he puts upon us because of our sin. Even that first sin, when Adam and Eve sinned and God punished them and cursed them and threw them out of the garden, that very moment he already had a plan to send Jesus. Already had a way to undo that curse which he began carrying forward from that moment. The same way, when God divided our languages, he already had a plan to bridge that division. And that's what we see on the day of Pentecost. Jesus promised the Holy Spirit, and he arrives, and he brings with him this magical gift to speak languages like never before. Now certainly when it comes to learning languages, you can learn languages and other cultures with a lot of hard work. But here on Pentecost, we see that God couldn't even wait for the apostles to do that hard work. He gave them that gift immediately, so from that moment they could start telling people about Jesus Christ, because God just couldn't wait for that word to get out. And so they continue speaking and proclaiming the good works of Jesus Christ. And the people there who heard the disciples were astounded, astonished, as we heard in our lesson this morning. And as we think about that experience, again, maybe you can think of a moment when you were surrounded by people not speaking English. When you're around that constantly, you kind of tune them out. You don't understand what they're saying. It's just kind of background noise. But then when you hear someone who speaks English, your ears just naturally hear that because you understand it. And it does. It kind of opens your eyes to what's going on around you. So for these people who couldn't understand what these disciples were saying about Jesus, all of a sudden they could. They were hearing their own languages, and they began to understand what they were saying about this guy Jesus. And the miracle wasn't just the languages, because even as they heard that, we know that some of them began to believe. And that's the true work of the Spirit. He uses languages to help that out, but the true work is working in our hearts to get us to hear about Jesus, to believe and trust in his death and resurrection for our salvation. And that's what we see in Pentecost. And you can imagine how this changed the world for those believers. And that's what happens when we can't communicate and we don't understand, and finally we do. It's like a light clicks on. I can remember the times when I was with Chris Tebbets and we finally figured out what he was trying to say to us. His whole face would light up and he would just get so excited because finally that connection and that understanding was there. That's what the people experienced at Pentecost. Finally understanding and hearing from God the good news of Jesus Christ. And thanks be to God, we've all had that same communication in our lives, even if it hasn't brought quite the same level of connection and joy that the miracle of Pentecost brought for the early church. But this was also in part to fulfill what God had said through the prophet Joel, that God was going to bless all of his children with his word, with his ability to prophesy, to be able to speak and understand God's word. Again, we see that on Pentecost, but we know that it didn't stop there. That the early church was blessed with the ability to speak languages, but for the later generations, the ability wasn't miraculous. It was accomplished through hard work of studying languages and being a part of cultures as missionaries. But nevertheless, the work continued. And now that good news of Jesus Christ has spread throughout the whole world, so that the gospel is heard in almost every language under heaven. Again, all that by the grace of God. Which isn't to say there weren't some hiccups and setbacks along the way. In fact, one of the more counterintuitive things that the Roman Catholic Church did in her history was to hide behind the language barrier of Latin. And the whole point of the church, the whole point of the Spirit's work and the work of all of us Christians is to get God's word out, to proclaim it to people so they can hear it and understand it. And the Roman Catholic Church decided instead to limit the Bible to Latin, to limit the church service to Latin, which was a language most people didn't speak or understand. So all the good news of Jesus Christ remained a mystery to them. This, of course, was one of the things that the Reformation overturned, and one of the blessings beginning with Luther, who translated the Bible into German so his people could read it and understand it themselves. One of the legacies and blessings of the Reformation is that we continue to have God's word in our own language. So that I'm talking to you here in English, not Latin, and that anytime you want, you can go grab a Bible and read it in words that you understand. Thanks be to God again for that. Another legacy of the Reformation, though, was music. And I just wanted to share with you a couple of quotes from Luther, because he was one who even more than others, really appreciated and loved music and how it was used to help proclaim God's word. So he said at one point, "I would certainly like to praise music with all my heart as the excellent gift of God which it is, and to commend it to everyone. But I am so overwhelmed by the diversity and magnitude of its virtue and benefits, as much as I want to commend it, my praise is bound to be wanting and inadequate." And elsewhere he also said, "We can mention only one point, which experience confirms, namely that next to the word of God, music deserves the highest praise. She is mistress and governess of those human emotions, which as masters govern men, or more often, overwhelm them. For whether you wish to comfort the sad, to terrify the happy, to encourage the despairing, to humble the proud, to calm the passionate, or to appease those full of hate, what more effective means than music could you find?" Well, I would like to suggest today, as we remember the events of Pentecost, when we think about that miracle performed by the Spirit of gifting men tongues and languages to speak, as we think about that, we shouldn't overlook the gift and the language of music. Because as Luther says, music has its way of transcending our language and our culture, so that it speaks to our emotions when we don't understand one another fully by the words that we're saying. It connects to us more on an emotional level. And so throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament, throughout the history of the church, music has always been brought into the service of God's word. Whenever men and women gathered to hear God's word, more often than not, it was accompanied by music as they sought to praise God. We, of course, continue that today. The Reformation didn't invent this use of music with God's word. It just acknowledged it and enhanced it. And we continue to do that still in the church today. And here at Trinity, that legacy has been carried on by another Chris, our own Chris Whitstrand, who for the past 47 years has been giving us her gifts of music and her love through her service of the church. And echoing Luther, I don't think I could possibly do justice to that lifetime of service in one simple sermon this morning. Whatever praise I offer is bound to be found wanting and inadequate. But I would like to, as a way of acknowledging it, point out just a couple of things. Now, the first of the things I'd like to point out is the nature of her gift. Like with language, you know, you see the miracle in Pentecost, and it happens sort of miraculously and instantaneously, and it's magnificent when language comes to you through the Spirit like that. It doesn't often happen. For anybody else who learns a language, it really comes more through hard work and study and immersing yourself in the culture. Well, when it comes to the language of music, lots of people develop this ability. For many, it comes through study and hard work of repeating lessons from books and learning that way. But however you learn music, it does take hard work. There are other few people who have more of a gift, an ear for music and rhythm and melody that, to those of us who don't have the gift, seems kind of miraculous. Seems kind of an instantaneous ability to understand and speak a language that doesn't quite make sense to us. Well, I would suggest that Chris is one who has that kind of God-given gift to speak and understand the language of music. And, of course, she developed that gift, again, with a lot of hard work and dedication and practice and service over the years. But it began with God and that innate ability. And that is just an amazing thing, worthy of thanking and praising God for all by itself. But the second point I would like to make, and perhaps the most important as we give thanks for Chris today, is how she used that and how she applied that gift in serving the gospel. Because I don't think any of us could say we haven't benefited from Chris's use of her gift here at Trinity in some way. I mean, think about all of the rehearsals, all of the church services, all of the ensembles and choirs and bells and praise teams she's been a part of, all of the work she did with the choirs at the school, all of the performances and Christmas programs and VBSs. She's been using this music for so many years, and in so many of those moments when she was playing or singing or leading others in playing and singing was also a moment when the gospel was being proclaimed. So that we weren't just hearing it with our ears, but maybe also with our hearts. So it is an amazing thing that God has accomplished through here at Trinity. As we think about that, whether it was Chris or someone else, I don't think any of us can say we haven't been blessed in our faith by music. Just think about your own faith. Think about how you understand and love the Christian faith. And I imagine you can't separate that from the music. Think about Christmas and Easter. Can you imagine having Christmas and Easter without those beloved hymns and carols that we know so well? Can you imagine your own growth in your faith without also thinking of those hymns that you hold dear or the praise songs that are your favorites to listen to and how that shaped your understanding and your experience and helped you grow deeper in your faith as a Christian? You see, the truth is we're all a little bit like Chris Tebbets because of our sin. We're all kind of cut off and isolated, especially from God, because of our sin. And today on Pentecost, we want to remember how God bridged that gap, how he gifted not just spoken language, but the language of music, but also how he gifted us people, apostles, prophets, pastors, teachers, musicians, parents, grandparents, friends, all these different people who have all had different opportunities to speak God's love to us, to speak about Jesus Christ in ways that helped us understand and believe. So whether it was a teacher or a pastor preaching a sermon or a musician playing music, or whether it was simply someone speaking the gospel to us in a way that finally clicked, it was always God working to give us his son, Jesus Christ. And so my prayer for you this morning is that as you acknowledge that you're a little bit like Chris Tebbets, my prayer is that God continues to gift you with people who speak his gospel in your life in ways that you can understand. And my prayer is also that as you're a little bit like Chris Tebbets, that you'd also be a little bit like Chris Whitson. That whatever abilities and gifts that God has given you, you would use that to speak his love and his good news about Jesus Christ to the people in your life. And as we acknowledge how Chris has done that in her life, we can say to her, thank you, well done, thou good and faithful servant. And to God, we can simply say thanks to Him for gifting Chris with the ability to play and speak the language of music. We can thank God for all of her hard work and dedication and sacrifice to the church. We can thank God for all the good that He accomplished through her. To Him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Celebrate the sacrament in this second part of our service. Just a note on our communion distribution, we do that at the rail. And as you come up, you will see some Exodus tape on the railing. And as we continue to kind of deal with the pandemic, and there are some who are still a little nervous about close contact, we do ask when you come forward if you would maybe try and keep separation from other groups that aren't part of your meeting group that you came with, or your family that you're comfortable with, so you can use the X's as a designation on how to keep your spacing, and the elders will try and help that as they send people forward. With that, though, please stand as we now turn to our Lord in prayer. We pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus, and for all people according to their need. Gracious Lord, your Spirit fills the world and gladdens your church. church in remembrance of all that Christ Jesus has spoken. As you once chose apostles to proclaim the resurrection, so open the mouths of your pastors and people to declare his praises to all who will hear, and comfort us with divine peace. Do not let our hearts be troubled, or Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of tongues, that you chose people in the early church and enabled them to speak the gospel of Jesus Christ in so many different languages, so that all could hear the good news of his death and resurrection. As Christ continues to be proclaimed to every nation and people throughout the world, we thank and praise you also for the gift and language of music that helps teach and proclaim it. Especially do we thank you for Chris, for her gifts, her dedication and hard work, her faithful service for so many years. As she has been a blessing to so many in her congregation and community, bless her and watch over her in retirement. And Lord, we ask that you help us to carry on her legacy of music here at Trinity. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, you have poured out your Spirit upon us, that we might believe you, help and sustain us and all Christians whenever we are mocked or ostracized for believing and confessing the truth of your word, that we may remain faithful. Bless all parents that they may faithfully catechize their children in your word. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord of might, preserve your people from their enemies, bring peace to the nations, and prosper the cause of life. Bless our leaders, especially our presidents, our governors, our Congress and legislatures, and as well as all judges and magistrates. Give them a relentless pursuit of just laws for the common good of all, with a heart of mercy for the weak and the vulnerable. Be with all the victims of mass shootings, and help us to find a way forward to curb the gun violence that continues to plague our society. And we continue also to pray for Ukraine, that you would end the war and violence there and bring comfort to those who are suffering. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, of compassion, forget not the sick and the suffering, but grant them healing according to your will. Especially do we lift up to you, Gary Snell, Doug Wilkins, Joanne Schaub, Diane Kransky, Kathy Kusina, Lacan Oumana, Terry Marcy, Jim Martin, Roberta Grant, Dorothy Gardner, Jean Allen, Rich Fun, Sandy Wojciechowski, Mike Starzak, Gloria Rivera, Melvin Shaw, and Luke Reed. Give them confidence that you know their need and will well supply them with all that they need to endure to the day of their coming, when all affliction will end and you will grant them perfect healing. And you will come grant consummation to all of us through our faith in Jesus Christ when he appears. Lord, in your mercy. Lord of grace, your Son has come among us and given us the privilege of a place at his table. Prepare us to receive his body and blood with repentance and faith for our good and for the flowering in our lives of your holiness and righteousness. Nourish and feed us, that in this holy communion we may be strengthened for your service. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Almighty Father, with your Son Jesus Christ, send your Holy Spirit into our hearts through your word to rule and govern us according to your will. Comfort us in every temptation and misfortune and defend us against every error, that we may continue steadfast and faith, increasing in love and in good works, and trusting firmly in your grace, that we, by Jesus' death and resurrection, may obtain eternal salvation. Through that same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever.
Amen.
And let us together confess our faith using the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Son. in heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again in glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom I have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in the Holy Church and the Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Hear my prayer, Lord. Give ear to my pleas for mercy. In your faithfulness, answer me in your righteousness.
Enter not into judgment with your servant, for no one living is righteous before you.
Heavenly Father,
we know that you have called each of us and sent your Holy Spirit to our hearts for the lives of the dead. Though we have such a great helper, counselor, and comforter, still we fall into we disobey your commands, we doubt your love, and we fail to love our neighbors as we should. Forgive us, we pray, for Jesus' sake, and continue to guide and strengthen us by your Spirit to live together as your people in holiness and righteousness. Amen.
God has given us the Holy Spirit that we might believe with our hearts and confess with our mouth that Jesus Christ is Lord. And trusting in his death and resurrection, we might turn from our sins and be forgiven. Upon this, your confession, then, as a called and ordained servant of Christ, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power.
testament in my blood, which is shed for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
created through God and love of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthened and preserved by steadfast and joyful faith and life everlasting.
Thank you. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace.
Amen.
Please. Last week I wasn't going to say anything about the pink card, so I'm not going to tell you to fill those out and put them in the plate on your way out. But before we go, I just had a couple other things to share with you. First of all, I wanted to say a big thank you to all of our members who helped with the cleaning up outside on Friday and Saturday, all the hard work you did. It looks great, and we really appreciate the help. Also want to make sure everyone knows that you're invited to stay for the luncheon immediately as we get cleared out of here over in the gym. I hope you can stick around for that. But again, thank you for being here. Thank you to our choir and our other musicians for your faithful service over the year. And thank you especially to Chris. Let us thank say you. Thank you to her for the great service. with our thanks and with the Lord's blessing. And as we go today, I pray the Lord will bless you as well, and I will see you at the door.
And the dinner.
And the dinner.